Let's stand at our feet for prayer.
We come to you this morning and we're reminded, God, in a time like this, Father, in the light of eternity, God, that life is short. It is just momentarily here. And God, we just ask here today, God, as we take comfort in the scriptures, knowing that, God, you are the God of all comfort. And God, you are the one that brings peace to our life. And I'm asking you, Heavenly Father, that you manifest your presence here today. Comfort and strengthen the family. God, help us, God, to remember, Father, Lord, the great times that we had with Keith here on this earth, God. And remember, Father, the life that you give us with him. And we thank you for that, Lord. And we, God, come to you knowing that our hearts are heavy, but yet we rejoice knowing, Father God, that he's in that place that you have prepared for ever born again believer. God, that is called upon you, a place of peace, a place of joy, a place where there's no more suffering. We thank you for that, God. We give you praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name.
Amen. I want to share a couple of scriptures with you today. The first one is in Romans chapter 8, verses 38 and 39. It's a wonderful promise from the Word of God by the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul. We'll read that first and then go to the second one there. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And that was Romans 8, 38 and 39. Now we'll share St. John chapter 14. This is Jesus himself speaking. Verse 1, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way, you know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
You call me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves, When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you've never failed and you won't start now. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Oh, Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And I will call upon your name, oh, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine. I am yours. You are mine. Oh, I am yours, and you are mine.
Amen.
Well, on behalf of the family, I want to thank all of y'all for coming out, being a part of this memorial celebration of Keith's life. You know, this COVID-19 has messed up our whole year. Back in April when he passed, everything was in a real lockdown. We couldn't do anything. And we kept sort of waiting to see if we could get rid of these masks and all that, but it seemed evident that we weren't, and we wanted to do something this year. And I know this, you know, the week before Christmas is not the best time to do anything, but we really appreciate each one of y'all that came out here to celebrate this with us. Marshall Keith Jackson. He passed on April the 13th, 2020. And he was born February the 19th, 1961. And I really remember that date. Matter of fact, I got to the hospital in time. So the survivors are Don and I, or his parents, and his wife of 39 years, Angie Jackson, his daughters Leslie, married to J.J. White, Lindsay Jackson, his son Landon Jackson, three grandchildren, Jackson Scott White, and Mary Catherine White, and James Cooper White. And of course, he had a brother, Scott, married to Emily Jackson, and several nieces and nephews. So this is a time of reflections. I think we have a video we want to show now. Let's go ahead and show the video.
My chains are gone. I've been saved. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Father.
We have a mic up front here. If anyone would like to come up and share anything about Keith, we want to open that up for you. I think Mary Catherine would share if y'all would let her.
So, as I was looking through those pictures, I was thinking, that's the first time I'd seen that, by the way. I think Lindsay made that. I was looking through those pictures, I noticed a couple things there. Number one, Keith was aging as those pictures progressed, and I got fatter. So those two things happened unequivocally in that slideshow there. So Granddaddy was right. We didn't get the opportunity to have a service when Keith passed away. So as I was driving here today, I thought into myself, how can we memorialize what he was to this community and to his family? So forgive me if I tear up here, but there's two things I'll remember about my father-in-law. Number one is he didn't mind working. He was a hard worker. And his love language was, I believe, gifts. He was a gift giver. He was a giver. And the way he gave to his family was, he was a provider. It was from a monetary phase. It was from a love phase. It was a ton of other adjectives that he was able to provide who he was to his family and to the community. There's probably not one person sitting in here that he didn't work on their car at some point. He was a provider there too. I will always remember. I bought a 2003 Toyota Tacoma truck, and he always wanted me to give him that truck. And to this day, if he was still sitting here right now, he'd still be trying to figure out how to weasel me out of that truck. He just wanted that truck. So, the other thing, and I think today would not be worth having if I didn't mention this piece of his life. He had an affinity for his grandmother, Mama Jack. He loved her, and every time something negative would happen or I'd go to him with an issue, an opportunity, he'd always talk about her. And I don't know why that was or what brought that up, but I think it was worth mentioning here today. If you knew him, you knew he loved animals. Not just one, but all of them. And there's a nice pet cemetery in the back of Keith and Angie's house today, from all of his friends that he had across his life. So that was important to Keith. That was who he was, part of who he was always going to be. So if you didn't like animals and you cared about going into Jack's, you're probably going to leave with some dog hair on you, just being honest with you there. That's just the way things were going to be. He had three grandchildren. Jackson, the oldest, Mary Catherine, the second, Cooper, the youngest. And both of my parents are deceased, so they have one maternal grandmother left. I see traces of Keith in all three of my children. Jackson, the hard-headedness and the stubbornness that Keith had at times. I think everybody appreciated that about him. Mary Catherine, her ability to light up the room with her smile. Keith had that. You can see it on that picture behind me. He didn't have to say a whole lot. And then Cooper, his sweet spirit. So I know that they'll always be a part of him, and he will always be a part of them, and for that I'm thankful. So I appreciate you letting me share, and thank you for being here.
Anyone else? I know this is a hard time. Appreciate Jason sharing what he shared. So, you know, we're all eternal spirit beings. You are a spirit. You possess a soul, which is your mind, your will, and your emotions, and you live in a body. Of course, the body is your earth suit. When your earth suit wears out, you can't stay. There's going to be a transition. I'll give you some scriptures to back that up. Over in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, the Word of God says, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." And then over in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, it says, "For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." And the scripture tells us over in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 9, that God is the Father of spirits. Whether you realize it or not, he knew you before you were born. Tells us over in Jeremiah 1:5, he's speaking to the prophet Jeremiah. He says, "Before you was formed in your mother's womb, I knew you." He's the Father of spirits. Every person living came from the Father of spirits into this earth. And we came alive to God because you came from God. You came into the earth alive to God. But the problem was we're all born into a world that's cursed with sin. And we know from experience and from the Word of God that sometime in youth there comes an age of accountability for every person. And that age of accountability comes when you realize what's right and what's wrong, what's good and what's evil. The Apostle Paul even makes reference to that over in Romans chapter 7, verse 9. He says, "I was alive once without the law, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died." He's not talking about physical death, because he was making that statement alive physically. He's talking about spiritual death, which is what the Bible calls separation from God. So we all come to that point in youth when we understand that we have the knowledge of good and evil. Sin is dormant in the flesh. Unfortunately, it's passed from one generation to the next through the flesh. And at that age of accountability, sin becomes alive and separates us from the life of God. And the scripture makes it very plain. Jesus himself said it, says you must be born again from above. Must be born again spiritually from above. And the way that happens is you put your faith and trust in what Jesus did for you through his death, burial, and resurrection. And his mother and I know there was a definite time in Keith's life when he made that commitment. I think he was about 14 years old, which is well past the age of accountability. without any us doing anything, us not really knowing anything about it till he done it. I know at that time we were in a denominational church that had services on Sunday morning and Sunday night. And I'm believing God that's coming back to the church Sunday night as well as Sunday morning. And thank God we had a pastor that would give an invitation to Christ in every service without exception. And I dare say if I ask for a raise of hands here today, most of you might have believed in him before you made the commitment, but you probably made the commitment in a church somewhere. And I know at this time, that Sunday afternoon, Keith was sort of withdrawn out in the garage of our home at that time, and his mama was real concerned about him. She thought something was really troubling him and something was wrong, and he just, of course, assured her everything was all right, but he stayed out there in that garage a lot of that afternoon. And when we went to church that night, he didn't even sit with us. He sat somewhere else in the church. And unbeknownst to us, when that pastor gave an invitation, he responded. And that's something we all have to do if we're going to have eternal life. And of course, when that happens, we need to, we have a responsibility then to get our minds renewed, our souls restored. And that can only happen through the Word of God. Romans 12:2 says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." God has a good and acceptable and perfect will for our lives here on earth. And even I would venture to say that multitudes of Christians never fulfill that good, acceptable, and perfect will here on earth. But thank God, even in eternity, God has a plan and purpose for every life. So we know Keith made bad choices in this life, but I dare say there's not a person under the sound of my voice today that hadn't made some bad choices. Of course, some choices have more consequences than others, but we all are guilty of making bad choices because we're human beings. And even though he made those bad choices, I don't believe he ever lost what he had spiritually, because if he had, he wouldn't have anything to do with us. He wouldn't have anything to do with God. He wouldn't have anything to do with the church. We believe you could lose it, but it's very hard to lose it. You just have to completely deny that God ever done anything in your life. And really what you're doing is treading underfoot the blood of Jesus. And he never did that. I know some of the... He had begun to come back to church. He even invited some people. He was inviting people to church. How many times, I dare say there's a lot of you out there that hadn't done that in a long time. He was inviting people to church. And I know there was one time when he was having some physical issues, and he was still, he'd gotten out of the hospital, and he was staying with his daughter, Lindsay, down there in Dothan, and Donna would go down once a week. And I went down a time or two myself, and we'd have lunch with him. But one of the times he was having lunch with Donna, Donna always expects me to say grace over the food before we eat, and she forgot it, and she just started eating. And Keith says, "Mama, you're not going to say grace?" I said, "You know, Daddy said an old hog will grunt before he eats." Y'all need to remember that before you eat. You ought to give some kind of thanks. Old hog will grunt before he eats. And I'll share this. This was not long, maybe right before they made the move with the business. One of his customers came in and says, "You know, we really like your mom and daddy, but we don't understand that church out there. I don't understand that speaking in tongues." And you know what Keith told him? "You need to read your Bible." So I know Keith is in our future. I'm convinced of that. We didn't really lose him because he's in the Father's house, and we'll see him again. Now, I don't know when these dogs die, they go to heaven or not. And I've heard some people give testimonies that have been caught up into heaven and said they are. Of course, we know there's horses there. The Bible makes that very plain. So I don't know where the same dog we got here is going to be with us in heaven, but I've come to believe that if that's not the case, then there'll at least be one like it there, just like it. And most of y'all don't know it, but Rosie, and she was really Keith's dog, because he always had a bunch of dogs, always. Rosie had to be put down this past week or so, last week or sometime. So if dogs go to heaven, Rosie's there. I believe Rosie's there with him. And if she's not, there's probably one just like him, like her, and all them others that he's had had over his lifetime. It was a lot of them that had to either died or had to be put down to keep from suffering. Aren't you glad we don't, you know, people shouldn't be put down because of suffering. That's God's. You know, we get confused sometimes. There's not an appointed time for everyone to die. Matter of fact, Scripture's, God says you can have 70, that's 70, and all you can believe for after that. What the Scripture says is, it is appointed unto mankind, once to die, and after that, the judgment. And of course, there's two judgments in the Scriptures. We'll all stand before a judgment seat called the judgment seat of Christ. Not to be judged for our sin if we put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ and we've been born again. But we'll be judged for what we did with Christ in this life. That's where the rewards will come into effect. And we'll all stand before that judgment seat if you know Christ. And then there's another one called the Great Throne of Judgment. That's where those that reject Christ, never make a commitment to Christ, will stand before God and be judged for their sins. I trust there's no one here under the sound of my voice that has not made that commitment to Christ. And if you haven't, you better think about that. You know, our world's changing so fast. Scripture says it'll wax worse and worse. But at the church, and then the church, the believers are supposed to wax better and better and brighter and brighter. And we can depend on God regardless of what's happening out there in the world. Three things here I just want to mention before I close, that, you know, God's love for you never changes. Jeremiah 31:3 says, "The Lord has appeared of old to me, saying, Yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness I have drawn you." We may become very frustrated with a lot of things that's happened in our lives, relationships, and, you know, keeping relationships like they should be. And sometimes it's hard to do because people are fickle. And people tend to change, either for the better or the good. But you'll never need to doubt God's love. Brother Jim read a scripture to us in Romans 8:38. God says, the Apostle Paul says, "For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." God's love never changes. Because God is love, and God never changes. And the second thing we need to remember is God's word for us never changes. Matthew 24:34 says, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away." And I believe God and his word are the same. We know it. The Psalms tells us the word of God has been settled in heaven forever. That means truth has been settled in heaven forever. Because this is our truth. The word of God is truth. God is truth. So as we pray today, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." See, we are praying that the truth will be established in the earth as it is established in heaven. There's a question asked of Commander Alan Shepard on May 5, 1961. As he prepared to board the Mercy capsule and be America's first man in space. Now, I don't know how many of y'all are old enough to remember that, but I remember that. And he was asked this question: "What is the one thing you're counting on most?" And his answer: "I'm depending on the fact that God's laws never change." So if it's going to be in his stability in our lives, it has to come from basing our lives on God's unchanging word. And the third thing here, God's purpose for your life never changes. Isaiah 14:13 says, "The Lord of hosts has sworn, saying, Surely as I have thought, so it shall come to pass, and as I have purposed, so it shall stand." So God is at work in our lives at all times, whether we realize it or not. Someone has said, I don't know what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. Our plans may change all the time. And we're conditioned to accept, expect, and invite change. There's a scripture over in Romans chapter 8. Verse 26 says, likewise, the Spirit also helps our infirmities, our weaknesses. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. In the original language, that says, cannot be expressed in your articulate speech. Now, he who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. I just thought of something else about Keith, and it wasn't long after he made his commitment to the Lord. He's still a young teenager. And we had gotten very involved at that time in the Full Gospel Businessmen Fellowship. Some of y'all probably never heard of that because it's not as active now as it was at one time. And we would go to their meetings, and eventually we even had a chapter there in Greenville, Alabama for a few years. But Keith and one of his buddies in this particular time went to that meeting with us there in Montgomery. And there was an evangelist from South Africa speaking, ministering. And Keith had this fungus on his feet even before we had moved to Greenville from Montgomery. And Donna had carried him to all doctors, and nobody could do anything from a medical standpoint to help him. And of course, there in Greenville, she'd carried him to the doctors there, and nobody there could help him. And it was continually getting worse. And he'd gotten involved in sports, and that really made it bad. Believe it or not, he played football there in Greenville, Alabama. And he was on the offensive line. I don't think he probably weighed 140 pounds wet. But that particular coach, he would use those guards, and he wanted fast guards because he'd pull those guards, to block for the backs running. As a matter of fact, it just come to me, Keith even won in his sophomore year in his high school. He won the offensive lineman of the year. So anyway, he was involved in sports, and this fungus on his feet was really giving him and his mama a hard time. And at the end of that service, that evangelist just asked, anybody that needs healing, stand to your feet. And Keith and his buddy both stood to their feet. I never did know what the buddy was standing for. And just that evangelist said, just pray this simple prayer of faith after me. And he prayed a very simple prayer of faith, having them repeat it to receive their healing. And of course, then, the service was over with. But when we went to the car, Keith was just, the first thing he did when he got in the car, he started tearing his shoes off. And his mama said, now, Keith, don't be disappointed now, Keith, because, healing is gradual, so you don't know, just don't be disappointed now. He tore those shoes off because he knew something had happened. Pulled his socks off. And that fungus was completely gone. He had flesh like baby skin, flesh on his feet, and never came back. Keith spent he spent 2 weeks with Don and I before he passed at our house because someone had to be with him all the time. He had spent he'd come out of the hospital 8 days in the hospital and 2 weeks with us. And I know sitting in sharing with him there in those 2 weeks, I said, Keith, do you remember God healing your feet of that fungus? Oh, yeah, he said, I remember it. I said, well, God never changes. God can heal you of what you're dealing with now. He can heal you of that. Of course, he didn't answer, but I just sensed that Keith at that point felt like God wouldn't heal him because of the bad choices he'd made. That's not the case. He's a God of love, and he never changes. So in conclusion, what will be your life stabilities of choice? And we need to remember these three absolutes. These are the three spiritual anchors for all our lives. Number one, know that God never stops loving you. Number two, know that God's word is always right and it's always best for you. And number three, God's purpose for your life is bigger than your biggest problem. Psalm 125:1 says, those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. So we expect to see Keith again. I believe he's in the Father's house, probably getting some extensive training of the word.
Excellent word, Brother Ken. So I'll only be a moment, but I would like to share something quickly, and we'll close with a word of prayer, but it's important. And I was reminded as Brother Ken was speaking and the pastor before him, and what an excellent choice of scriptures we've heard this morning. And I was thinking about the renewing of our mind that comes by being in the Word of God. And I think of a particular passage that I want to share with you now that has a promise associated with it. And as I share this, be mindful of this fact. I'm sure, been in many church services and many funeral services before. But there's something that just really stands out that is so crucial for every listener in any service that you're ever in. But beyond that, day to day, know this one thing. It's not what I know that changes my life. It's what I obey. So there's a promise associated with this, but it only comes to those who will obey it. Paul's writing in the book of Philippians chapter 4. And near the end of this book, he writes, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. if you know someone long enough, you're going to have some good memories and you're going to have some unpleasant memories with anybody that you know long enough. We're challenged in that passage to think on those things that we just read. Whatever's true, honest, just, pure, lovely. And here's the promise. Those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do. And the God of peace shall be with you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. It is unchanging. It is settled in heaven forever. And our challenge is always to obey it, because that's where you meet us and change us as we journey through life day by day. And Father, I thank you for Keith. I have many good memories with Keith, and I cherish those. Undoubtedly, all of us in here that have known him for very long have good memories with Keith. We saw many on the slideshow of good times. I can recall his pleasant demeanor that he usually exhibited, a calmness and a gentleness that was the norm for him most of the time. And Father, we thank you today that you work all things together for good to those that love you, those that are the called according to your purpose. We know that your purpose is to conform our lives into the image of Jesus Christ. And we pray, Father, that we would cherish those good memories. Lord, that you would use us in our lives, that as we have been blessed by you through other people, that we would be a blessing to others as well. Help us, Father, to carry good memories forward, but also to be mindful that we make good memories for others, but that we do all things for the glory of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I believe with that our service is concluded. Thank you so much for being here.
Appreciate everyone coming. God bless you.